Great. Okay. Well then, welcome to our first Pinnacle Global Citizenship event for 2022. My name is Anya Olofsson. I'm a CTA student and your host for today. Pinnacle is a leadership program at Nelson Mandela University that develops top accounting students for future leadership. Before we start, just a few house rules. This event will be recorded. Please make sure your mic is muted and your camera off during the event. If there are any questions, please feel free to pop them in the chat throughout the session or wait until the Q&A after, where we would love for you to unmute and put your camera on so that we can see you. It is now my utmost pleasure to introduce our guest speaker, Mandy Muchnick, an accomplished CASA. Mandy spent a large part of her career in investment banking at Investec and private equity, where she worked across a wide range of industries. Mandy has also done significant work in social upliftment and chairs the prestigious One Young World organization in Africa. In 2020, she was recognized as the SAICA 35 Under 35 Influence Category winner. With a deep passion and a track record for making a meaningful difference in the world, she joined the founding team of Panda. She is driven to be a part of changing the narrative around mental health and achieving Panda's mission at making mental health and well-being resources available to all while ensuring that people get the right care at the right time. So without further ado, I hand over to you, Mandy.
Thank you so much. I'm just checking, can everyone still hear me? Good, you can give me the go ahead. Thank you, Anya. It's really great to be with all of you today. I think I'm really passionate about being in rooms that are about storytelling, because I always say, you know, if you can't see it, you can't dream it. And, you know, sometimes just hearing someone's story can change how you see the world. I know I had those people in my life. So yeah, thank you so much for having me here to share a bit of mine. And today I just really want to talk about, I guess, how a small town girl from Parais, which is a tiny town in the Free State, has learned to navigate some really highly dominated male industries and also develop a passion for using my skills for good at the same time. So I by no means have everything figured out, but I am told that everyone on this call most people are students and under the age of 35. So given that I'm reaching the upper end of that band, I thought there might still be some things that I can just share with you, not just about my journey and where I've ended up, but really what's worked for me along the way. So I think my background is an important piece of the puzzle to really understanding who I am. And on my dad's side, I was really influenced by people who had a real love for business. So my grandparents were child refugees from Lithuania, and they landed up in the small town of Parais in the Free State. Their families had actually thought that they were on a boat to America. So you can imagine their shock when they landed in South Africa and in this tiny town where there wasn't really much. But so from their side, I really learned what I think hard work and grit means. And that's something that all of you, I'm sure, are really well on your way to learning, being on the path that you're on. I think this year, specifically if everyone's in CTA, will really test you in ways that you can't imagine. So don't underestimate the character building journey that you are already on. And then from my mom's side, she's a teacher. So I really learned, I think, what it means to have a passion for seeing other people reach their full potential. And so I think you'll see how both of their, I think, backgrounds, very different people, but are really woven into who I am. And at their core, they really both had a love for community and making a difference. So from a business perspective, I think the fact that my dad was an entrepreneur, albeit a small town entrepreneur nonetheless, he really left me, I think, with this feeling that I wanted to leave a legacy one day and make sure that the world was different because I was here. So that really manifested in a way for me that I wanted to make, I guess, people's lives easier who hadn't been given the same hand that I had. So while in some ways this sounds glamorous and idealistic, I have to say that you really need to know yourself quite well and stay true to your journey. So I'll give you some examples why, but I did my articles at Investec. It's a very competitive environment. And when you kind of find yourself in that environment, I was also a competitive athlete growing up, you have to be quite true to yourself to not get, I think, wrapped up in that feeling of winning and wanting something because it's what everyone wants. And so I actually looked for quite different paths when I was at Investec. And I think people often, you know, when I would get a certain rotation that everyone wanted and turn it down to do something different, I remember having a meeting with someone once and they were like, why are you doing that? And it's just because I felt like I had to stay true to who I was. And I was quite lucky because that ultimately led me to joining the Investec property team, where I was part of building the Investec property equity business, which was a private equity business essentially for property. And we built a really successful book of, I think it was over R1 billion in 18 months. And while that sounds great, and again, I'll come back to that, you need to be true to yourself, is that maybe if I'd gone to those rotations or those areas where, you know, you won it and everyone was trying to be in it, those were established teams that were already doing well. But to go to an early stage venture, and that was actually in hindsight an easy environment because I still had the safety nets of the bigger corporate brand. But you have to be someone who actually wants to go through those ups and downs and kind of travel the gravel road, so to speak. So as Anya said, that was kind of the end of my time at Investec, which I really enjoyed. But I got the opportunity to then be part of a private equity fund that was starting up, and then now part of the founding team at Panda, which I'll tell you a bit more about later. But you can see the trend that I am someone that does enjoy that gravel road. I do enjoy building. But through, I think, the business side the business side of my life, I just wanted to share some of the learnings that I've taken over the years. So the first is that if you want to achieve something out of the ordinary, you have to become okay with failure. And that's something very difficult for people who are studying to be a CA, SA in specific. You know, you already probably here because you're a high achiever and you aren't used to failing. I remember when I moved from being the top accounting student at the end of accounts 3, and then I failed my first test, my Saturday test, as we used to have it, UCT and GDA. It really rocked me, you know. But again, this time will teach you that you need to be able to fall and stand back up again, because that's life if you want to achieve something out of the ordinary. So I think if you look at countries around the world, Israel actually has the second highest number of venture capital per capita in the world. And there it's actually more strange if you go out for dinner and you haven't tried something and failed, where I think still in South Africa and most part of the world, we put so much pressure on ourselves to be perfect. So that would be my first lesson. Life is a journey, so don't be too hard on yourself. The second would be for any of the ladies on the call, and also the men, I think, to be cognizant of this. But as a woman, you have to really go all in and almost work double as hard in the first few years of your career. So I say this with respect because I have a husband who is very hands-on. We have 2 children under 3. But nonetheless, there are just things that they can't do, starting with the fact that you have to grow a child for 9 or 10 months. And so your life does change in ways that you can't imagine. And yes, you will hopefully have a partner who carries a lot of that weight. But your original capacity of 100% drops drastically, maybe to your 70%, and then starts to climb up again a bit as things kind of equalize. But so don't be tough on yourself in that journey, but make sure that you spend the first few years of your career really building what someone termed to me as your soft NAV, so being your skills. So don't worry so much about what you being paid, because that will come with time, but make sure that you're always building experience and skills kind of in those early years. The next one is that male-dominated industries will be everywhere. So again, this is for both the ladies and men on the call, because I think it takes both to kind of be cognizant of it and bring about change. But it's sometimes difficult, I think, to forge in when you try fit in a group circumstance. So I'll give you an example, but I feel like I'm someone who's always fitted in, actually, until I got into this team, which they just all loved cricket. And that is the one sport that I do not watch. But lo and behold, every Monday or whatever, when we came to the office, this was the, you know, when I happened to join the team, it was cricket season. And it was so hard for me to kind of break in. And I couldn't understand why. I just no one would speak to me or, you know, kind of include me. And I realized it obviously wasn't malicious. People naturally speak about what they're interested about over lunch. But how you break into a group when you maybe feel like being the odd one out is to start making individual connections with people. So as soon as I started having one-on-one conversations with people, you realize that we all have something similar in life, no matter how different your backgrounds are. So try to find that one thing that you can connect with someone on. And then in the weeks to come, it was really interesting how the conversations around me just started to change because all these kind of common interests came to the fore. And these are people who were at my wedding many years later, and even post leaving Investec, I still have good relationships with. So yeah, strong relationships, I think, come from building that one-on-one connection. And then the last one for this part would be that you should always take charge of your own development. So I think sometimes, you know, you can fall into a trap when you are part of the CA journey because so much of your life is planned for you. Your 4 or 5 years of studying and then the 3 years of articles, you're kind of just going through the motions. And if you end up working for an audit firm or a bank, you know, things sometimes come to you. But I kind of learned this by accident, I think, in some ways, because when I left Investec, it became even more so that, you know, I had to take charge of my own development because no one was going to do it for me. So I just think if you have that attitude, even within the confines of a university or a company, you're now within a structure that has so much resources that can actually accelerate your work. So yeah, just be proactive around your own development and really always, we call it always be learning at Panda, but really have a lifelong commitment to learning. So that was a bit about, I think, my background on how the past few years have unfolded. But before that, while I was studying accounting at UCT, and my brother was 1 year below me doing the same thing, I think we both had a moment where we felt, are we studying the wrong thing? Because we both carried this desire to make a difference in the world, make a difference in our country. And I actually tried to change degrees. I think it was in my second year. I didn't manage to, and I'm thankful for that. But essentially, you know, we then went back to the drawing board and we said, well, you know, this is a good degree to study, but how can we actually use our skills to still achieve what we want to do, which is to make a difference in the world? And that's where we started social enterprise at UCT. We started a project called CIA that would go into Khayelitsha and teach unemployed would-be breadwinners how to start a business. So everything from how to open your bank account, your business plan, to then how to do basic inventory. And we would give them basically a micro loan at clothing stores to start up a clothing business, essentially. And what happened was in the first year, only 2 out of 10 businesses were a success. So to the point of being okay with failure, I think we could have thrown in the towel then and be like, well, this is just too, we can't do this. You know, there's so many complexities in this kind of work. But we said, let's take these learnings and try again. And in the second year, we had 25 sustainable businesses. And CIA actually became a Dell top 200 project around the world, much to my brother's credit, actually. So from there, when we moved to Joburg again, we were going into articles and we thought, how are we going to use our skills for good? And this is kind of where I think my mom's love for education came through. But after volunteering at a few creches, we realized the need firstly to help on the education side and developed a curriculum that was spread around schools in the area. And then we registered our own profit called Imagination. So Imagination's been running for around 10 years, just under 10 years now, where we initially started with small projects, but essentially to date, we have had over 500 children who've been through safe schooling environments now after we built two schools. We've had over 30 educational mornings through our Parties with Purpose initiatives, and we've reached over 20,000 individuals through our annual Winter Warmer initiative that we've run over the past few years. But, you know, this is actually all only possible with the help of the many loyal volunteers that we've gotten over the years. So we've had 200 consistent donors and volunteers. And throughout COVID-19, I think when people were really struggling to raise money for projects, we actually raised more than we've ever raised before, and were able to support families with monthly food bags, make sure that educational materials went to all the children who were no longer able to go to school, and were with parents, you know, who were mostly out of salaries during that time. So I think there are many lessons that we learned during our time working with imagination, but the two biggest ones probably are that, you know, when you do go and work in communities and try to do upliftment work, that consistency and reliability are really the only currencies that matter. So all too often we see people with really good intentions who come and try and do things, but you know, you actually need to think about it like you're going into someone else's home. You're there to support them and their dreams, and also to not create, I guess, expectations that can never be delivered on, because that's really value destroying, not just to relationships, but really to the greater ecosystem of our country. So our success is really rooted in the fact that we've been able to create deep, very close relationships with our partners on the ground. And they really drive the strategy. And I often say that we actually learn more from them than they do from us, but it is a true partnership. And then the second part is that there are going to be so many opportunities outside of your studies and your jobs that really give you a chance to learn things. So I think, you know, I've really learned so much more, ironically, about leading teams and project management, which was maybe not in my early kind of articles experience, but that I gained through this work that I did. And I think a lot of people often say to me, like, how do you find the time to do this? And I think this is actually another important lesson that, you know, in this day and age, we have so much information coming our way. And it's really important to firstly consume the right information and be really deliberate about how you spend your time and what you spend it on. So I think my secret has always been that I've been part of the 5 a.m. club my whole life. Unfortunately, at the moment, it's mostly for the wrong reasons, but I'm caught up with two young children. But before them, even in my school career, when I was playing competitive tennis, I was on the tennis court at 5:30 every morning and got in 2 hours before school. And then once I started work, my kind of 5 to 7 a.m., I always used to call that my self-development time. So once you start working in the day, there'll always be more demands on you and you'll probably never be finished. But generally, if you are a morning person and you carve out that time, you'll be surprised by what you can do. So that's really the time in my early career that I used to build our nonprofit, to build One Young World, and to kind of really actively take charge of my own development. And so now, how do these two things tie together? So for a really long time, I felt that I had these two parallel worlds, really. But then I really started to appreciate how it was the underlying skills from becoming a CA that were helping us grow imagination and achieve kind of huge and sustainable impact on the ground. But it was the leadership and empathy that can only be gained when you actually work on the ground that were giving me certain skills that kind of differentiated me from my peers or my age group peers at work and made me an asset in business and started giving me really a voice at tables I didn't expect to have when I was so young. So I think, you know, the key takeaways from there really are that to have global impacts, you require building the necessary skills to solve problems on a grand scale, but while at the same time being on the ground and close enough to the problems that you're trying to solve. So it's sometimes a difficult balance to get, but it is possible. And I think it's these experiences that really prepared me for when my two worlds did finally, formally start to collide. So that really started to happen when I got the opportunity to attend One Young World for the first time. And it's very difficult to do One Young World justice. So I'm going to hand over back to Anya so that she can just play a brief video to give you some context about what I'm going to speak about next. So while she brings the video up, I'll just say that when you watch this, just know One Young World's not a far-fetched dream. And you have people sitting in this meeting today that are really passionate about getting the best talent, the opportunity to go. So don't be afraid to ask.
You are the young leaders who are going to have to be a force during this next year for the brave, ambitious, urgent, transformative leadership that the world needs.
Today's young generation is the most powerful generation in the entire human history. What a power that is. Yeah, you can be the
greatest, you can be the best. One Young World's most international gathering of young people, bringing together over 190 different countries. Only the Olympic Games brings together more.
We believe that from among you, there will be world leaders who drive real positive change. And we ask you, each of you, is it you?
As the first truly global citizens, you know better than anyone that cultural and ethnic diversity can be a source of strength.
The one defining characteristic of everybody at One Young World is that you believe the world can be a better place.
The future is always contingent on now.
You understand more about the biggest revolution that's changing the world, the digital and social revolution.
Just because I grew up in a disadvantaged community doesn't mean that I'm disadvantaged. If I can write a book on my smartphone, what's stopping you?
It's not small, this. It's not a talking shop.
We implore you, the United Nations, to value the lives of those dying as much as you would your own.
As One Young World, you have tremendous power to help redefine the role of business in society by changing companies from the inside and building new ones.
One Young World is the only leadership forum that has given this center stage.
The energy that it gives to us, but not only the energy, it's the hope. It's the hope for a better future.
The one thing that we should never do again is to never, ever take peace for granted.
Help me prove that ISIS and other extremists don't represent all Muslims.
When I was crossing the Gobi Desert, I thought nobody in this world cared. It seemed that only the stars were with me. But you have listened to my story. You have cared. Thank you very much.
It's so exciting to be in this room with all of you, to be in the best think tank imaginable.
The partnership potential in this room is incredible.
Customers have saved 2.6 million tons of carbon with us.
We established medical care for 25,000 people.
One out of every three children around the world get immunized with the vaccines that we helped to manufacture.
It will go down in history as the first ever app created for the world by One Young World.
Thank you, Dublin.
We look forward to seeing you in Bangkok.
I hope that from this wonderful meeting of young people, the next Madiba will be born.
I come away from these sessions hopeful and reassured that the future of our world is not lost.
Well, thank you so much for sharing that. You can see why it's difficult to describe, but sometimes when I'm having a slow morning, when I get to the gym, I still actually play that video because it fuels me so much. And I was really fortunate to be there. But like I said, it was really the experiences that I'd had up to date and the work that I'd done leading up to that, that firstly helped me take advantage of the opportunity that was given to me to be there. And I was selected as one of the 40 delegate speakers in my year, which was a great privilege. And then really to come back and I got the role of coordinating ambassador. So One Young World is not just a four-day summit. That's really where your journey begins. But we're really passionate that, you know, about the fact that this is actually your lifetime membership to the most impressive community in the world. So I was the coordinating ambassador for One Young World, where I built the Southern Africa community and managed over 500 people to make sure that they were united and got real opportunities to showcase and amplify their work post the summit. And we were actually the most active global community in 2018 and are always in the top three. So really proud to see that. And then I also used to just really have meetings from anyone who would listen to me. So starting with, you know, I got the opportunity because Investec sent me. So I used to go back to our CEO every year and say, it's One Young World time and we need to build a delegation. And so Investec sent 8 people every year, and then just really had meetings, I guess, with anyone that would listen to me. And this year we actually had 90 people go from Southern Africa. So I think, you know, the key lesson in that is really that once you've had an opportunity, you know, make sure, I think it's Kamala Harris who has that famous saying, you know, I may be the first, but I won't be the last. And that's kind of how I always felt about One Young World. You know, when you want to become a CA, there's this very structured route for you to go on. And when you want to be a leader, I think there are people who are natural leaders in life, but we expect a lot from our leaders today. And I think, you know, the cliche that the only constant is change, and we really need to build the type of leadership that this continent so desperately needs. So that's why I remain passionate about getting people to attend the summit and build our delegation. And from there, my two worlds started to collide more and more. So again, you know, life's a journey, but we then, as One Young World, formed a partnership with Chartered Accountants Worldwide, who govern all, you know, I guess the equivalent of SICA globally, to start an initiative called FinBiz 2030, which is an initiative that unites the finance and business community to address the sustainable development goals. And so I think the more you do the work, again, the more kind of self fulfilling it becomes, that you end up on the journey that you want to be on. And so today, I guess that's all these things led me, despite, you know, having a really good career in private equity and some people thinking that I was crazy to give that up. But when I got the opportunity to join two really impressive entrepreneurs in South Africa, one by the name of Alan Sweden, who built the Akeso Hospital Group, which is the mental health and psychiatric hospital group in South Africa that's sold to Netcare, and the other one, Alon Litz, who built something I'm sure we all use, but Uber. So he was the first employee for Uber in Africa and really built it for sub-Saharan Africa. And, you know, our mission now is to solve what's known, I guess, as the silent pandemic. So we all speak about COVID-19, but there's been another pandemic really even before COVID, but that was just exacerbated by COVID, which is the real mental health crisis. So, you know, that's where I am today. And my overall takeaways are that the business case for doing good is really growing every day. So I think it used to be a nice to have that you had the sustainable development goals on your agenda as a company, but now we see increasing pressure for that. So there are going to be a whole range of opportunities that open up, I think, to your generation, where you actually care about these mission-driven things, but you are actually going to have the opportunity, you know, as a CASA, to hold your business accountable for living out those values and not just having checkbox approaches. And then the last one is really to create ripple effects wherever you go. So I think the thing that I'm most proud of, if I look back on my career, is the work that I've done with One Young World to empower people around me. So like I was saying earlier, you know, I had this great experience and I would still be where I was today, I think, you know, if I just took the experience and carried on. But, you know, there's only so much change that you can really affect as one person. And so I think empowering people around you is really what creates the ripple effects of change. So the old African proverb goes, if you want to go fast, go alone. But if you want to go far, go together. So I encourage you all to do that. And yeah, thank you so much for having me to share my journey.
Thank you so much, Mandy, for sharing your journey with us. Like, I'm sure we can all take something out of it and apply it in some way in our lives to achieve our dreams and goals, but also to make sure other people are also achieving their goals and their dreams, and by empowering them, like you said. And then just to touch on, please do tell us more about the Join Panda app and the silent pandemic that you've been talking about and that you've helped develop, and how we can make use of it in our daily lives to ensure that we are always putting our best selves first.
Thank you. So as I said, it really is a silent pandemic. And I think to solve it, firstly, we need to start thinking about our mental health in the same way we do our physical health. And, you know, I think there's been many barriers to why people don't get mental health support or just even invest in it in a proactive manner. And those three barriers are really what the Panda app is built around. But we believe that people don't get help for three main reasons, being stigma, cost, and not knowing how to enter the system. So there's a lot of work in society to be done around the stigma around mental health. I think, you know, if you actually Google the word stigma in the UK, the explanation of stigma is mental health, which is just crazy. In South Africa, it's HIV. And then the second word is mental health. So if you download the Panda app, you're actually not asked for your real name, and you can interact in group settings in our functionality called the Forest. You know, and people don't need to know that it's Mandy that's struggling with a particular issue. I can go into the session, and if you imagine this Teams call, I guess in the same way that everybody else is now, where your videos are off, but you can raise your hand and ask a question, or you can, which the functionality most people use is the chats, you know, the chat function. So it'll be hosted by a mental health professional, or someone with real lived experience, but with a professional in the session. And it's really your first step to learning about a particular topic that you know, maybe worried about. Am I suffering from anxiety or depression or struggling being a working mom? It really is, you know, day to day things as well. And then it also gives you the ability to connect with people going through similar things to you. So I think, you know, mental struggles are often very lonely journeys. And it actually helps just knowing that you're not the only one going through it. So, you know, it's about creating those communities and learning from other people going through similar things to you. So that's really the stigma piece. And then the other piece why people don't get help is really cost and not knowing how to enter the system, which speak to each other. So, you know, if you have a physical issue, whether it's anything from a paper cut to tearing a ligament in your ankle, like your brain immediately knows where to go in the physical health system, right? But from a mental health perspective, I think we just don't know, myself included, before I went on this journey, but you just don't know how to get the help you need, and you think that is prohibitively expensive. But the truth is, unless you have a clinical issue like clinical depression or anxiety, you know, there's a range of other issues we have every single day and that you'll all face when you start your career. Our country is complex. We literally have sessions on, you know, the triggers around load shedding, triggers around black tax and the pressure around being the first in your family to have a job. So it's, you know, it's everyday things that like might not start as a massive thing, but like if you leave it and it manifests into something bigger, you know, then you need expensive interventions. So the app is built, I guess, with those three key issues in mind. And there's the Forest that I touched on, there's the ability to connect one-on-one with professionals. And then there's a content library and assessment. So if you want to take the first step in your mental health journey, the app is free to download. So maybe while you're all sitting there now, you can take out your phones and search Join Panda. We actually set up a promo code as well. So when you do your profile, it's called Pinnacle Cares. I think Anya will send out a follow-up as well, but capital P and capital C in the mix. But really the forest, which are those audio sessions, the content and assessments is free anyway. And with the promo code, it'll unlock 3 free one-on-one sessions for each of you, if you choose to use them. But yeah, the forest, the content and assessments are free. There's some really cool sessions. So tonight she's a medical doctor, but she's also an influencer. Her name's Dr. Nesu. And so it really is a good time to start your mental health journey, because she's hosting a session at 8 p.m. around kind of daily rituals to improve your mental well-being. So something quite general and something we could all use. But Monday nights generally are for all the kind of work-life topics that we struggle with, balance. It's, you know, I think it's relevant to studying. Tuesday nights are different women's series. Wednesday's parenting. I don't know if there are any parents on the call, but Wednesday nights are parenting, and Thursday night is called our man cave. So, which I really encourage, if there are any men on the call. We know it's difficult, especially for men, to talk about mental health. And yeah, we have some really inspirational and exciting hosts, from leading business leaders also just coming into the app, I guess, to talk about their journeys and play their part in destigmatizing mental health. Because I think when you see someone who's really successful, you automatically think they have it all together. But you know, I think we all struggle at some point. Adulting doesn't come with a manual. So yeah, just feel free to reach out if you have any questions.
Well, yeah, that is super exciting to know that something like that is available, especially after COVID, which you said just brought, I think, all those underlying feelings just to light. And I think people have had to deal with things a little bit more face first now. But yeah, thank you so much. I'm sure there will be many of us, now that we know about it, that will make use of Join Panda in the future. So thank you for helping to make a vital resource like this available to students too. Now we have come to the last part, and we would like to open the floor for any questions that anybody in the audience might have for Mandy. So please feel free to share, to put it in the chat box, or to raise your hand and put your camera on. Siba, yes, please.
Good evening, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I have to. Okay, let me switch on the camera as well. It's been a while since I've switched on the camera. Okay, hello everyone. I wanted to ask, really, you talked about everything that you've done from university onwards with One Young World and the app and all those community projects, and you I think you said one of your dreams was you just wanted to have your legacy in the world and everything and just leave your print. And I just wanted to ask you, how did you take that from like thought into action? Or at what point did you realize this is how I'm going to make my footprint? Because I'd like to believe everyone wants to change the world, but not exactly sure how to go about it. Yes.
Yeah, thank you. That's a really good question. And I think I can honestly say I never thought I would be working on mental health. So, you know, I think you start and you just do the work. I think especially even, I say my generation, your generation, because I am getting old now. But the older generation love to speak about all of us as like wanting things to come quickly, you know, and it really is that there's no shortcut to hard work. And I think if you're authentic, if you want to make a difference in the world, firstly, try surround yourself with people who think like that. Try to find existing projects that you can learn from, because I think there's very few people who just off the bat go and do something life-changing. And I really believe in that saying that you are the sum of the average of the people you spend your most time with. So, you know, surround yourself with people that have that same mission as you, and just keep collecting that soft NAV, the skills, because it's the skills you'll need to execute the dream to make a difference.
Thank you very much for that response. I think, yeah, it really makes sense. in the way that we're doing. Yes.
Thank you.
Good question, Siva. I think I have one from my side. You spoke a lot about like the Imagine projects and all those projects that you started with the school and all of the businesses. And you said there were quite a few volunteers and donors. How, if say we wanted to, is there a possibility that we can volunteer or, you know, donate, whether it's time or resources, and how we can go about doing that?
Oh, thank you so much for asking. So I think you're all based in PE. So if you do ever find yourself in Johannesburg, the two schools are in the Lanseria area, and please reach out to me. I'd be happy to try organize something for you guys to go there. And yeah, I'll send you a video on Imagination that we have that just shows you, I guess, how the main school really has developed over the years. And I can just share initiatives with you. So we never blanket fundraise. And I think that's been the key to our success, because whenever we fundraise for something, it's to execute something. So, you know, I think people over the years, you know, someone who's donated to us once has generally donated many times, because they see where their money goes directly, and they see the work being done. And this really does come back to you. We actually just got someone to join our team who's much more senior and accomplished than me, and said to me, I actually know who you are. And I was like, how, you know? And he said that he donated to our initiatives over the years. So yeah, I think, again, I guess when you building your brand, my mom always, or she said this to me when I turned 18, but she said, you don't, you only, you know, you can make mistakes in life, but there's only one thing that you only get one shot at, and that's your brand. So I think, yeah, to add on maybe my response to earlier, also just build your brand as one of consistency and delivery.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'll definitely then send that information on to anybody else that would be interested.
Thank you.
I'm not seeing any other questions. Is there anybody else that has something that they would like to ask? Something in the chat. So Siva has another question in the chat. He wants to ask, how do you manage your time wisely to handle your professional work life, your community upliftment, and raising a family as well?
That is a very good question. And some days are a lot less glamorous than others. But I am really very strict on my diary. So I literally put every single thing I do in my day in my diary. That is my time management technique. So if someone sends me something to review and it takes me 10 minutes, I put it in my diary. And my role in Panda, because I am the only person in the team with a finance background, I'm building out the finance function. But my biggest responsibility outside of that is really building our whole sales funnel and heading up our partnerships. So I also color code my diary, and, you know, anything that's a sales meeting, for example, is in green. And at the end of the week, I look at my diary, which I'm looking is here up top, and I'll see, you know, is most of my diary green? Has it been green this past week? Or, you know, is it purple, which is all internal stuff? And constantly kind of reflecting on what I've spent my time on. Did I spend my time on the right things? And I think that is a technique, you know, that can be used even now as a student. Like, again, what are you spending your time on? Are you spending, I even put my Instagram time on so that it can shock me when I feel like I've, you know, mindlessly been scrolling, to be that like checkpoint, you know, when I look back on the week, I'm like, oh, I didn't exercise, but I spent 3 hours on Instagram. I could have exercised, right? So I think being really strict about how you spend your time definitely gets much harder when you have a family. This won't be a new thing that people, you know, if many people have said this before me, but I often feel that I'm falling short as a mom, or I'm falling short on the work front, because, you know, it's very difficult to be, if you're 105% person, to be that level at both things. But I think you realize that it ebbs and flows. So, you know, sometimes it's more lean to the one side, other times to the other side. But your health really is the most important. And I think if COVID taught us anything, you know, we were saying at the beginning of this conversation how we've all actually just quickly moved on now from COVID. But I think that's a lesson that we shouldn't forget. You know, it was the big equalizer. And so I do try kind of practice what we preach as well at Panda to carve out that time. But yeah, I think it's really constant and ruthless prioritization.
Okay, I see our time is almost done. Yeah, Sunita says thank you. I think for us students as well, I think just to get on top of that time management is so crucial. I mean, if we haven't gotten it down by now, I think it's an important lesson to learn going forward. I do have a last question, so I'm hoping just everybody would be fine with a few more minutes. It's just more about the One Young World and how, you know, we could get involved. Like, how do they, you know, go about choosing who gets to go, or, you know, how do you, what's your link in, you know?
Yeah, perfect. So you guys are very lucky to have Mrs. Raper, I think, on your team, because she is someone who's very passionate about building the kind of leaders that we need. And I think when I spoke to her initially, I almost felt like she was giving me my thoughts back to me, because she, you know, she really is passionate about getting you guys the opportunity to go. So One Young World really selects, I think, the best talent globally. It is an expensive, I guess, opportunity if you had to fund it yourself, but there are scholarships that run. So the last summit was just 2 weeks ago in Manchester. The next one will be in Belfast I think it's the 2nd to the 5th of October next year. And so you should follow the One Young World Instagram page. Just type in One Young World. There's also a One Young World Africa page, which is OYW_Africa. And on those pages, you'll see when scholarships also become available. So hopefully we can get a general scholarship just for Pinnacle students. But if you are doing incredible work already, please reach out to me. Let me know who you are so that when these scholarships kind of come up, I can just quickly ping you and let you know there's a scholarship that's opened up for South Africa. There is a specific scholarship for South Africa every year. There's a couple on the continent that different companies sponsor. They are very competitive. I think there were, I don't want to lie, but I think it was over 20,000 applications this year for, I think, around 400 scholarship spots. So it's competitive, but I always believe that we really do create the best and we are up there to compete globally. So don't count yourself out, apply and reach out to me. And then again, I think unfortunately most of the kind of in-person meetings in South Africa happen in Joburg, just by virtue of the fact that about 90% of ambassadors are based in Joburg. But look out on the Africa page when events are happening. We've become much better at live streaming them as well, so you can tune in and still have access to the content.
Thank you so much. Well then, if there is anybody else that has a question, you are more than welcome to still send either myself or Mrs. Raper an email, and then we can forward it on to Mandy, and then she can get back to you. Mandy, thank you again for joining us. It was incredible to hear your journey, your experiences, and we really appreciate you taking the time to share everything with us. And we look forward to seeing what you achieve next and how your projects do over the next few years. So from all of us, we wish you the very best in all of your endeavors. And then to everybody else, thank you for taking part and listening in on this event. I hope you can all walk away with a little nugget of inspiration or food for thought, and yeah, that you may be putting yourself, your best self first always. I hope that everyone has a lovely evening further and a great week ahead. So thank you and goodbye.